One of the strengths of bitrise is that if you don't want to, you never have to touch a configuration file to maintain your CI/CD pipeline. You can do it all in our graphical user interface. But that doesn't mean you can't look under the hood and configure your builds in the old-fashioned way. That's what the bitrise YAML file is for. Every bitrise app has its own bitrise YAML file. That's where we store the build configurations, your workflows, your step inputs, your trigger maps, and a few other things. When you modify a workflow in the workflow editor, you actually modify the bitrise YAML file, but you can also edit it directly. And that's what we'll talk about in this video. To do so, open an app on bitrise and go to the workflow editor. You'll see a tab called bitrise.yml. That's what we'll need. Click on it and your app's bitrise YAML configuration will be opened in our online YAML editor. Now, it's important to remember that you can edit just about anything here. You have access to all the bitrise features, but you can also easily break things. So if you're not sure what you're doing, stick to the GUI. In this video, we won't talk about all the advanced configuration options, but we'll go through the basics of the bitrise YAML file. The file starts with three properties that you normally don't have to modify, and we won't go into details about them now. The format version, the steplib source, and the project type. You can read more about these in the bitrise CLI documentation. But the fourth option, the trigger map, is very important. It is the equivalent of the triggers tab in the workflow editor. This is where you can configure when and in what circumstances should bitrise launch a new build. In the example here, you can see that according to this trigger map, every time code is pushed to any branch, the primary workflow should be triggered. You can add your own triggers here in the same format. Set a push branch, a pull request source branch, or a tag property. Add a value, for example, the name of the branch that should trigger a build, and add the name of the workflow you want to trigger to the workflow property. To set up an actually meaningful trigger, you obviously need workflows too. That's next in the bitrise YAML file. The workflows property contains the available workflows. Under workflows, you simply add a name and a colon, like the deploy workflow here. And you have a workflow that the CLI can run. Let's do it now and call the workflow test. Please note that the proper indentation, as seen in the example, is very important. You won't be able to save the file if it's not structured correctly. Under this workflow, you can set the workflow specific properties, such as the workflow's own environment variables. And of course, you can add some steps. We'll talk about the latter now, and it's by far the most important part of bitrise. If you're interested in workflow specific environment variables, check out the bitrise CLI documentation. Adding a step is easy. Under the steps property of the workflow, you can just add its name, or to be more precise, its step ID. You can find that in two ways, either look up the step on GitHub, as all our steps are open source, or just add the step on the workflows tab and continue editing in YAML afterwards. As you can see here, our first step in the deploy workflow is the activate SSH key step. It has no version information in its ID, unlike the steps below it. This means that bitrise will always look for the step's latest version. You can also lock the step to a specific version here, as seen for example with the git clone step. Or alternatively, you can lock a step to either a major version, as you can see here with the cache pull step, or to a minor version, as you can see here with the script step. So let's try to add a new step to our previously created test workflow. We'll add a new script step and set it to a major version 1. First, you add steps colon under the name of the workflow, and then under that, you just type dash script at 1.x.x here, and under the curly brackets. Again, please take care to indent properly, as you can see here in our example. Click save and you're done. The next time you run a build with a test workflow, it will run the script step's latest version within the major version of 1 with the default configuration. At the moment, we haven't added any inputs to our step. As we mentioned before, this doesn't mean it won't run, just means it will run with the default input values. In the case of the script step, it will merely print hello world. But of course, we want a bit more than that. So let's remove the curly brackets. Hit enter and type inputs below. Hit enter again and add a content input. We'll add a so-called block chomping indicator character to control how line breaks and trailing empty lines are handled. And then you can add your own script, just about anything you want. That's how all step inputs work. You add the name of the input and a valid value, and that's it. Feel free to experiment to try things out. Just be sure to back up the bitrise YAML file first. You can download it by clicking the download currently saved config button, and you can play around with it locally too. And if you need more in-depth information about what you can do, we once again recommend our bitrise CLI documentation. You can read about everything you need to know about how to use the most powerful features of bitrise in your build configuration. If you found this video useful, don't forget to give us a like. See you next time.